It's half past eight.
It's half past eight, New York time. Time to wake up America and stump the experts. Each week at this time, Lucky Strike sets up a board of experts for you to test your wits against. You furnish the questions, and our experts try to answer them. For every question used, Lucky Strike will reward you with $10 in war stamps. If the question is muffed, you get a total of a $50 war bond plus the 24-volume set of the Encyclopedia Britannica. Send your questions to Information, Please, 480 Lexington Avenue, New York City. If our editorial staff edits your questions a bit, don't fret over it. In case of similarity, we'll have to be sole judge of who shall be paid. Then all questions become the property of Information, Please. And now light up a Lucky Strike as I present our Master of Ceremonies, book reviewer of the New Yorker magazine, Clifton Fadiman. Mr. Fadiman.
Ladies and gentlemen, Information, Please continues as ever, unrehearsed and spontaneous, the spontaneity tonight being supplied by our three regulars, John Kieran, Oscar Levant, and Franklin P. Adams, plus our guest expert, the Dean of American Sports Writers, Mr. Grantland Rice. Now, we're going to begin with a question from Larry Gould of Vinyl Haven, Maine. This question is divided into four parts, and we'd like to get three out of four. What was the answer to each of these questions? The first question is, what are the bugles blowing for? What, Mr. Rice?
I said Filey's on parade.
You've got the right poem, all right.
To turn you out.
Yeah, that's
the
right.
The color sergeant said.
Thank you. Mr. Rice got it about the same time that Mr. Adams did, so that is quite correct. That's from what poem, Mr. Rice?
Danny Deva.
Danny Deva by Rudyard Kipling. Very good. Now, here's the second question. What do you read, my lord? What's the answer? Mr. Adams.
Words.
Yes, words. And that's from what source, Mr. Adams?
Shakespeare,
right. How about the play?
Might be Hamlet.
It is. Very good. It might be Act Two. It might be Scene Two. Who says who asks the question? Who answers it?
I don't know, probably
you're all right.
Newspaper seller.
Isn't it Polonius?
Yes, Polonius asked the question of Hamlet. Here's the third question. Is there anybody there? Mr. Adams.
Said the traveler.
That's how the poem goes on. Now, what was the answer to the question?
I don't know. It was...
Keep it going.
Walter de la Mare who asked the same.
Yes, you've got the right author and the right poem, the listeners. And what was the answer to the question, is there anybody there? Said the traveler, knocking on the moonlit door.
If a woman answers, hang up.
that I don't remember.
Well, Mr. Kieran?
I don't think there was any answer.
Ah, that's right.
He went on.
That's right. The answer is there was no answer. Silence answered. Remember it now, Mr. Adams?
Mm-hmm.
Now, here is the fourth and last question. Who's in that hen house? Mr. Kieran.
Nobody but us chickens.
That's says here on my card...
Just us chickens.
On my card, Mr. Adams, it says, parentheses, an old joke, close parentheses. Is that right? An old joke.
I wouldn't call it old, maybe 75 years.
That.
We don't call
this?
That old, do we?
I should say not.
Mr. Adams and Mr. Grice wouldn't call that old. Okay, you've got yourself dated, gentlemen. How about this one from George Trevor of this city? What sports figure is associated with each of these accomplishments that were achieved under pressure? Now, in the first case, this sports figure scored a Rose Bowl touchdown with seconds to go. Who was that and under what circumstances? Mr. Rice.
Well, that is the pass in the Duke game with about 13 seconds to go.
That's right.
I know the two men, but I saw the game.
Well, you got the right one. You're perfectly okay. Who was the one who...
There's a forward pass from the quarterback to this end.
Al Kruger and Nave, was it?
Nave.
That's
Nave
right.
To Kruger.
USC, then, is that right?
That's right.
Right. University
of Southern California, as Mr. Levant reminds us. And about when was that, Mr. Rice?
That was 2 years ago.
Yes, 1st of January, of course, in 1939. Who won, remember?
Southern California won 7-3.
Hey, that is pretty good. You're almost as good as Kieran over here, Mr.
That
Rice.
Good.
You ought to become a sports writer. How about this? A sports figure who helped win a pennant with a home run in the dark. Kind of late, Mr. Levant.
Would that be Hartnett?
Yeah, Gabby Hartnett. Now, give us the circumstances.
That was about 4 days before the Pittsburgh got knocked off of the pennant. I went in the morning for 2 years. About 3 years ago, I think.
It was against Pittsburgh.
Yeah, it was.
In September 38.
Pitched.
That's right. The score was in the ninth inning. The score had been tied 5-5, and if Hartnett had struck out, the game would have been called in a kind of darkness, but he didn't. Got a home
run.
Not a hard run. How about this? He tied for a championship with a double eagle. Mr. Rice.
Gene Saracen at Augusta. He won the Masters with a two on a par five hole.
Very good. What is a double eagle, Mr. Rice?
Well, there's really no such word as that, but an eagle is a three on a par five hole, and Gene got a two, and so we call it a double eagle and a golden eagle, and we just created the word.
Okay. Well, that gives us 3 out of 3, gentlemen. How about this one from Mrs. Leo S. Moss of Selma, Alabama? Quote at least, let's say 4 lines, that would give you 1 apiece, from poetry or song, each of which mentions equipment used in a different sport. For example, sticks and stones may break my bones. That would mention sticks, which is used in hockey. Now, let's see if we can get a few others. How about Mr. Kieran?
Oh, that I were a glove upon that hand, that I might touch that cheek.
That's very pretty.
Romeo and Juliet.
Yes, that's lovely. That's lovely, Mr. Kieran. Sound as if you've been rehearsing that somehow. that gives us a glove in baseball, of course, and in boxing. Now, how...
Any game, any...
Any game, yeah.
If music be the food of love, play on.
And what's the...
Lawn tennis.
Yes. That's okay, Mr. Adams. That's okay, except that what I wanted was actual equipment.
Oh, equipment.
Equipment, yes. Mm-hmm. And equipment, in this case, used in lawn tennis. Mr. Kieran?
Well, there was an old woman who lived in a shoe. You wear shoes in a lot of games.
Yes, in a great many games. Also, when you're not in a game.
He flew like a bat. Well, I don't know that one.
Come into the garden, Ward. The black bat night has flown would
Thank
be one.
Thank you.
Is that
saves
all right,
me.
Mr. LeBan? That's the last helping out you get from me tonight. How about a couple more bits of it? Well, think of the equipment used in football, for example.
As bat and ball, the player goes from...
Go ahead.
From Omer Khayyam.
Yeah, it is from Omer Khayyam. I bet Mr. Kieran can straighten us out on that. I don't remember the lines.
How does it go,
no,
Johnny?
No, I don't know
but
that.
But I know the bat and ball are involved.
The player
in one
strikes
of the lines.
Or something
of that sort. How about one or two more?
I have another.
All right.
Tis from the same Romeo and Juliet. Tis well the mask of night is on my face, else would a maiden blush be paint my brow.
Yes, very good, Mr. Kieran. Mask, of course. Very good. You've been reading Romeo and Juliet lately, Mr.
Once
Kieran.
In a while.
Mm-hmm. One needs it for encouragement sometimes. How about goal? Life is real, life is earnest, and the grave
and
is
the
not
grave
its
is
goal. After the ball is over, a lot of songs and poems that have the word ball in them. I think we did get 4 on that. Now, how about this from Albert C. Trussell of this city? I want you to identify the composition in which each of these clarinet cadenzas is heard. They're going to be played for us, 3 of them. Tell us what they're from. Let's have the first.
The Liszt Rhapsody.
Yes.
Number 2.
That's right. Second Hungarian Rhapsody. That's very good.
If I hadn't sung the subsequent part, I'd have never gotten it.
You did very well. Part of that sounded a bit like a clarinet, too, Mr. LeBan. Let's have the second one now.
Sounds like in Mr. Kieran's domain.
Dunno.
Hmm?
It doesn't sound like what I have down here. Would that be from the Light Cavalry Overture?
It would.
Yeah? Light Cavalry. Get it now?
I'll forget it.
Von Suppe's Light Cavalry Overture. All right. That gives us 1 wrong. Now we have to get the last one right or lose a $50 war bond.
Scheherazade by Rimsky-Korsakov.
Thank you very much, Mr. LeBant. That's grand. That gives us 2 out of 3. And thank you, Mr. Duques, for the clarinet playing. Now, how about this one from Franklin Peters of Seattle, Washington? This is an animal question. Get 3 out of 4. How many animals drew the sleigh in the song Jingle Bells? We all sang when we were in school, Mr. Kieran.
4 horses.
4 horses drew the sleigh in the song Jingle Bells.
4 horses on the sleigh. 1.
Mr. Adams.
1.
1. That's right, Mr. Adams. How can you defend your answer, Mr. Adams?
Oh, what fun it is to ride in a one-horse open sleigh.
Yes, right.
That's right.
How's that?
That's right.
Have to call that wrong, though.
You certainly should. Or you can't count.
You just count too often, Mr. Kieran, that's all. Now, how about this one? How many animals hauled a load of borax? Hauled a load of borax. Mr. Kieran.
20.
20, mules. Yes. I thought you were going to say 40.
No.
Yes, 20 mule team borax. Very good.
I thought you were going to say borscht.
Animals don't have any.
No?
No, they're in the borscht. They don't draw. How many animals will be coming around the mountain when she comes? Mr. Levant.
Well, the man who sings it must be an animal, then.
No.
They'll be coming around the mountain?
Yeah.
Well, that's as much as I know.
How many animals will be coming around the mountain when she comes? I don't know what verse that's in, third or fourth. She'll be driving 6 white horses when she comes. Remember that, Mr.
Six.
Adam? Six. Six is right.
You can't keep a secret from that boy.
You know, that Levant is very quick, Adams. That Levant is very quick. Now, how about this one? How many animals actually brought the good news from Ghent to Aix? Be careful,
yes.
Mr. Kieran. How many?
One.
One. Now, I thought
three
you were
started
four.
Out, and I galloped, Dirk galloped, and Jarvis
we galloped,
galloped
all three.
Yeah, but only one finally.
One got there.
Yeah, what was the name of the horse, remember?
Golly, I forget. He found it in the marketplace.
Name was Roland.
That's right.
Name was Roland. Well, we only got 2 out of 4. That sends a $50 war bond to Mr. Peters and a set of the Britannica, and sends us on to a question from Wilbur Wood of the New York Sun, New York. I think this might be up your alley, Mr. Rice. How about identifying for us the sports celebrity who pitched a World Series game in his 40s? That come back to you? Mr. Levant had his hand up at once. Mr. Levant?
Last year, Freddie Fitzsimmons.
That's very good. Freddie Fitzsimmons. What was the game, remember?
It was the game in which, unfortunately, a ball hit his knee in the latter part after he had pitched brilliantly. Mm-hmm. And it was quite tragic because he had never won a World Series game, and he might have.
Righto. That came back to you, Mr. Rice,
immediately.
Right. Well, did John Quinn pitch a World Series game, too, in 1930?
For the Yankees?
For the Athletics.
For the Athletics, but nobody ever knew his real age,
so
you can't count that.
He was around 46, though, when he quit.
Around 4. He was kind of coy. Why did he keep his age so secret, Mr. Rice?
Well, we asked him that once, why he lasted so long. He said, well, what are you going to do when you got a wife and 6 kids?
Something in it.
What am I going to do?
It's still an unanswerable question for you, isn't it, Mr. Levant? Identify the sports celebrity who played 50 minutes of football at the age of 54. Well, we're going up. Mr. Rice.
That's my old friend from Yale.
What was his name?
Fudge Heffelfinger.
Fudge Heffelfinger. Everybody knew that, apparently. What game was that and when
he
was
he played
it,
at Columbus, Ohio, when he was 54 with Bo McMillan and a pro game for a charity. And then when he was 64 years old, he played 15 minutes in Minneapolis.
Did he really?
When he was 64 years old.
Good for
him. His birthplace.
That's right.
And finally, how about a sports celebrity who competed in the Olympics at the age of 48? Who was that?
Wasn't Jim Thorpe.
No, it wasn't.
I know.
Got it? Mr.
Policeman.
One of the policemen who throws
policeman.
Things.
Yeah, who was
Pat,
it?
Pat somebody.
No,
McGrath.
Not Pat.
The other fellow.
Matt McGrath.
Yes, Matt McGrath. Yes. He was a weight thrower in the 1924 Olympics, born in 1876. Can you name a sports celebrity who played a tennis match for charity at the age of 59?
I don't want to be libelous.
I can't think. Mr. Adams.
Papa.
That's right. It was Mr. Franklin P. Adams who at the it was only last year, as a matter of fact. Mr. Adams played a beautiful game.
Kieran and Adams won.
Kieran and Adams won, yes. That's true. For the British War Relief. I would be glad to describe the game for you, but I'd rather not over the air.
6-4.
6-4. I remember refereeing
6-4.
That game.
That's all.
I played a better game as a referee, Adams, than you played down there in the court. Now, so far, Lucky Strike has paid out one $50 war bond and one set of the Encyclopedia Britannica. And Mr. Cross, believing in the principle of better late than never, answers a question that was posed more than 3 centuries ago.
The question, as Mr. Kieran's friend W. Shakespeare asked it, was, what's in a name? Well, ladies and gentlemen, names are what you make them. And the name Lucky Strike has come to stand for fine tobacco. Actual reports from tobacco markets all over the South year after year show that the makers of Lucky's consistently pay the price to get the lighter, naturally milder leaf. For example, in Clarkton, North Carolina, at auctions of the 1939 crop, the American Tobacco Company paid 32% more for the tobacco it bought for its cigarettes and other tobacco products. Yes, 32% above the average market price published by the United States Department of Agriculture. And that crop, properly aged, mellowed, and blended with other fine crops, is in the Lucky's you buy today. In short, Lucky Strike means fine tobacco. Mr. Fadiman, every smoker knows that in a cigarette, it's the tobacco that counts. So aren't the facts behind the name Lucky Strike worth acting on?
Mr. Cross, you've presented the proof positive in just 60 seconds. Now we'll go on with a question that comes from Norman Lippincott of Atlantic City, New Jersey. Now, here's what we're going to do, gentlemen. We have a sports announcer down here with us, and we're going to reenact famous events of fiction, but they're going to be described in the manner of sports announcers. I want you to identify each famous event of fiction from the description that our announcer gives us. All right, let's have the first.
Doesn't look so good for our boys today. Last of the ninth, two to tie, three to win, two out. But they've still got that one big out left, and you know anything can happen in baseball.
Describing what event?
Out of baseball, you mean?
Well, this is a fictional event.
Fiction?
Yeah, it's fiction. It's imaginative, not necessarily a novel. Mr. Levant? Mr.
Casey
Kieran?
At the bat?
Casey at the bat, yeah, sure. Remember, Flynn and Baker each get a hit, but Casey at the end strikes out. Now, that was fairly easy. The second one's a bit harder. Let's have it.
There he is, impatient to mount and ride. Steady now, steady. There's the first signal. He springs to the saddle. There's the second signal. He's off.
Ah, Mr. Kieran?
One if by land and two if by sea, and I on the opposite shore will be. Paul Revere.
That a boy, Mr. Kieran. Very good. Very good. Now the third and last.
Oh, what a scrap, folks. You've never seen anything like it. Both fighters game as they come and battling every minute. They really got their teeth in this one. The air is full of cotton. And it all started when he said, bow wow, grrr, and the other answered,
meow. Well, Mr. Kieran, our sports expert.
That the gingerbread dog and the calico cat?
Yeah, not gingerbread.
Well, a something dog and a calico
yes,
cat.
Yes, that's right. It was a gingham dog and a calico cat. That's right. The famous fight they had. Very good. Got a special talent for this sort of thing, Mr. Kieran. How about this? From Ross Amos of Toronto, Ontario, Canada. Get 2 out of 3 on this. It's about boxing champions. Name the boxer who held the heavyweight title before he held the light heavyweight championship. Held the heavyweight title and then the light heavyweight championship, Mr. Levant.
I'll only guess. Was it Fitzsimmons?
Yes, it was. It's a very good guess. Bob Fitzsimmons. He lost the heavyweight title in 1899, and then 4 years later, he won the light heavyweight crown from George Gardner, was it, Mr.
That's
Rice?
Right, George Gardner.
George Gardner. I guess they're the only one answer to that question. Nice going, Mr. Levant. How about this one?
Well, I thought it was fictional for a moment.
No. Name the boxer who was a welterweight champion before he became a lightweight champion.
That I can...
Yeah. Got that one? We got two. You sure about that?
Yeah, I'm sure, but Mr. Kieran is sure, too.
Well, I'm sure. You're both sure.
Give it to Oscar.
Armstrong.
Oh, you can both take it together,
Armstrong.
Boys. Who was it? Henry Armstrong. Yeah. Whom did he defeat in each case?
For the welterweight title, he defeated the boy from Chicago. I know him very well.
Mr. Kieran?
Bonnie Ross.
Bonnie Ross.
Bonnie Ross, Mr. Rice, that's right. And, of course, the lightweight champion.
Lou Ambers.
Now, name the boxer who was a European bantamweight champion once, and then he later fought a heavyweight fight for the championship, Mr. Rice.
George Carpentier
against Dempsey for the
heavyweight.
Well, he must have begun, Mr. Rice, pretty early in the game to be a bantam.
He finished late, too.
He started about 15.
What's the weight of a bantam?
The bantam goes about 26.
No, that's feather. That's feather. It's 120.
118.
118 or
120. Well, that's right. The bottom is 118.
118. He must have put on an awful lot of weight later on to be able to compete for the heavyweight crown. Well, that gives us 3 out of 3. Now, how about this from Bessie Squires of Pasadena, California? I want you to recite from a poem that mentions each of these rivers. You don't have to give me the line that mentions the river necessarily, but just recite from the poem that does mention the river. The first river is the Chattahoochee. What poem mentions the Chattahoochee River?
Chattanooga Choo Choo.
Lanier wrote the poem. I remember that.
Good work, Mr. Rice. That's quite
Sidney
right.
Lanier.
Yes, that's right. How, Mr. Kieran?
I think it's called something from the hills of Habersham.
Yes, it. That's one of the famous lines. Out of the hills of Habersham, down the valleys of Hall, I hurry amain to reach the plain, so forth. And Mr. Rice reminds us that's from Sidney Lanier's poem, The Song of the Chattahoochee. Now, how about the River Alph, A-L-P-H? Mr. Rice?
That's where Alph, the sacred river, ran.
That's the one.
Heaven's measureless to man.
Good work. What poem are you quoting from, Mr. Rice?
I'm quoting from Coleridge.
Kubla Khan.
And quoting correctly, too. That's right. Now, how about the river, the Congo? The Congo. Mr. Adams?
That's Vachel Lindsay.
Give us a couple of lines from the poem.
Then I heard the Congo.
Saw it, I think.
Then I saw the Congo, and that's all I can remember.
That's not bad.
1, 2, 3, 4, kick.
Conga.
Then I saw the Congo creeping through the black, cutting through the jungle with a golden track. There are a number of other famous lines from the Congo by Vachel Lindsay. Now, how about the river, the Oregon? Gee, that's a sticker. I didn't think anybody would know that. I've got two hands. Mr. Adams and Mr. Kieran.
Thanatopsis.
That's
good.
Right.
Very good. And Mr. Kieran, give us a
Where line. Rolls the Oregon.
Where rolls the Oregon. Itself in the continuous woods where rolls the Oregon and hears no sound save its own dashings.
That's very good.
Period.
I don't think that's so easy to remember. Good work, Mr. Adams and Mr. Kieran. That gives us 4 out of 4 on rivers and sends us on to a question from Carl Bingham of Chicago. Get 2 out of 3. Can you name the author in one of whose works an actress marries a gambler and in another a waitress marries a millionaire? These are 2 separate works, but by the same author. Name the author, Mr. Levant.
I can be wrong. It's no penalty, is
it? It's happened before.
Edna Ferber.
That's right.
Yeah.
Very good.
That thing about Mississippi Showboat.
Showboat.
And what is it, the other one?
Waitress marries a millionaire.
Oh, that's that Saratoga thing, is it?
No.
So
no.
Big?
No,
well, let's go through the whole list.
Come and get it.
Come and get it, as Mr. Adams reminds us.
That's
yes,
right.
A novel of Miss Ferber's about 2 or 3 years ago. Now, how about this one? An author in one of whose works, a doctor leaves his wife, and in another of whose works, a businessman leaves his wife. This author likes that motif, apparently.
It sounds like George Kelly.
No.
It could be.
That wasn't... I wouldn't
know what you mean.
I wouldn't take that as an answer.
No.
Mr.?
Somerset Maugham?
No.
Sinclair Lewis.
Sinclair Lewis. Right. Mr. Adams is right. Gee, I wish you'd spoken up just a second earlier.
I didn't
one
make any answer.
No, but Mr. Kieran did. Mr. Adams?
One is Babbitt.
No, you're wrong, I think.
Main Street.
Arrowsmith.
Yes, Arrowsmith. And Arrowsmith, the doctor leaves his wife. And what's the other one, Mr. Adams? Businessman leaves his wife in what work?
Babbitt.
No, in Dodsworth.
Oh, she leaves him, Mr. Fadiman.
She does.
And I never called you Mr. before.
Why this?
I should say.
Why this sudden respect?
Oh, I mean, he had to leave her because it was disrespectful even in the book to have continued.
In Babbitt? Was it in Babbitt?
No, I'm talking about Dodsworth.
Oh, in Dodsworth. Yeah. She leaves him?
His name was Sam, I remember.
I thought the businessman left his wife in Dodsworth.
Well, if he left it, that was the only pride
he
had left.
I think he did. He left her.
I think he did. Yeah, well, in any case, Sinclair Lewis is the man. Are you through with this argument, gentlemen, or are we going to go on with this all the rest of the evening? How about this one? Name an author in one of whose works a married man... Gee, this stuff keeps on forever. In one of whose works a married man elopes with his first wife. Got that clear?
I got it.
Okay. And in another of whose works, a wife gives up her husband for 2 other men, it says here.
Well...
Mr. Levant?
In such wholesale style, it would be Noel Coward.
That's right, yes. You almost guessed that. That's right.
Private lives.
Private lives.
Designed for living.
Designed for living. Very good, Mr. Levant. Yes.
That was hearsay, designed for living.
I
don't mean my answer. But...
That was very accurate work, Mr. Levant. Now, how about this one from William H. Appledorn of Maspeth, Long Island? Here's another animal question. What animal made each of these statements? What animal made each of these statements? Get 2 out of 3. Here's the first statement. Pray render with your liquid tongue a bit from Guttadamerung. Mr. Rice.
That was the fox to the gullible raven.
In what poem?
A poem by Carroll.
Guy Wetmore.
Yes.
Carroll. The sycophantic fox and the gullible raven.
That's
and so
right.
The crow completely doused and gave the jewel song from Faust.
I remember the end of it, Mr. Rice. I always like the last 6
lines. The moral.
Remember it, Mr. Adams?
It begins the moral.
The moral is a fox is bound to be a shameless sinner, and also when the cheese comes round,
you know it's after dinner.
But what is only known to few...
The fox is after dinner, too.
That's right. Thank you, gentlemen. Now, what animal made this statement?
and ate it all up, and ate it all up.
Is that one of the grandma wolf things? The
three well, you're not too far away.
Well, they ate it all up.
Who actually said, and ate it all up?
That little girl who,
No, you got your characters mixed. You're in the realm of fairy tales, which is right. It's the little bear talking of Goldilocks in the Three Bears.
That's
remember?
What I meant.
I know you did, but you said wolf and grandma. It has to be the little bear. How about this one? You got the right story, Mr. Levan, just got the wrong set of characters. Who made this statement? What animal did? For some of us are out of breath, and all of us are fat. Mr. Kieran.
Well, that's from Alice in Wonderland, and I believe it was the oysters.
The oysters?
Oysters.
That's right. And they said, made the statement to whom?
To the walrus and the coffin.
To the walrus and the coffin. And how about giving me, this is a question from Marie Brenneman of Stockton, California, give three familiar expressions that involve a military title or term, such as private property. Mr. Kieran.
Corporal punishment.
Corporal punishment. Any others?
I don't understand the question.
Well, how about major disaster, Mr. Adams?
Admiral character.
Yes, very admiral character.
Caviar to the
admiral.
General.
What?
Caviar to the
very
general.
Very good. Yes.
Admiral Crichton.
Admiral. We had that pun once.
No, you had admirable before.
I see. You think it's Admiral Crichton, General Mudd, or Sergeant Locks, maybe. Now here's Mr. Cross, who, with all due deference, nevertheless thinks he could supply some questions that would floor every one of our information please experts.
Well, Mr. Fadiman, with the help of Speed Riggs, I could easily find some questions on tobacco that no one but a tobacco expert could answer. For tobacco knowledge is a very special kind of knowledge which literally takes years to acquire. Ladies and gentlemen, that's why, in choosing a cigarette, it's wise to profit by the judgment and experience of tobacco experts, men who spend their lives buying, selling, and handling tobacco. Now, sworn records show that with the independent experts, auctioneers, buyers, and warehouse men, with men who know tobacco best, it's Lucky's 2-to-1. These experts know just who buys what leaf, and year after year, at market after market, they see the makers of Lucky's consistently pay the price to get the finer, lighter, milder tobacco. For example, in Oxford, North Carolina, at auctions of the 1939 crop, we paid 23% above the average market price published by the United States Department of Agriculture. At Pamplico, South Carolina, 34% more, and so on all over the South. And that crop, properly aged, mellowed, and blended with other fine crops, is in the Lucky's you buy today. No wonder that Lucky Strike has won the overwhelming preference of independent tobacco experts. Isn't this expert's stamp of approval worth your acting on? Just remember, Lucky Strike means fine tobacco. And in a cigarette, it's the tobacco that counts.
Thank you, Mr. Cross. This evening, Lucky Strike has paid out one $50 war bond and one set of the Britannica. Thank you, Mr. Rice, for coming tonight. Next week, Mr. Adams and Mr. Kieran will be here, along with our old friend Christopher Morley, and as our special guest, the author of This Above All, soon to be seen as a motion picture, Mr. Eric Knight. Remember, for every question answered correctly, the sender gets $10 in war stamps, and for every question that stumps our board, you get a total of a $50 war bond, plus the complete 24-volume set of the Britannica. Send letters with questions and the correct answers to Information, Please, 480 Lexington Avenue, New York City. And now, a parting message from Mr. L.A. Speed Riggs, famous tobacco auctioneer from Goldsboro, North Carolina.
That chant, ladies and gentlemen, is your reminder to smoke the smoke tobacco experts smoke. For these independent experts know Lucky Strike means fine tobacco. At market after market, they see us pay the price to get the milder, better-tasting tobacco. That's why, with men who know tobacco best, it's Lucky's 2-to-1.
This program came to you from New York. This is the National Broadcasting Company.